Good evening. Thanks for tuning in. I'm Gadi Schwartz coming to you from Los Angeles. And here are the stories we're watching tonight. Breaking news from the Supreme Court, who finally have a decision about that abortion pill, Mifepristone. The drug is staying on the shelves for now. But does this mean the fight is over? And millions of Americans are still in danger from the same storm system that brought deadly tornadoes in Oklahoma and flooding in Texas. And you know that massive Netflix documentary on the so-called Doomsday Mom? That trial is now underway as Lori Vallow stands accused of killing her kids because she thought they were zombies. And at least one American is now among the nearly 600 killed in Sudan as the country gets closer to an all-out civil war. Breaking news tonight, the abortion pill known as Mifepristone will still be available, at least for now. The Supreme Court has agreed to essentially put a pause on a lower court decision made by a Trump-appointed judge 2 weeks ago. Now, at the time, it invalidated the FDA's approval of the drug from 23 years ago, and it threatened to eliminate the medication that's used in more than half of all American abortions. In a statement, President Biden applauded the stay and vowed to, quote, continue this fight in the courts. It's next headed to a New Orleans-based federal appeals court on May 17th. Now, joining us is Kristen Gibbons Fedden. She's a civil rights attorney and a former prosecutor. Kristen, can you break this down for us? A stay has been granted. The pill will still be available while this continues to play out in court. But which court are we now talking about? Is this still going to be fully decided by the Supreme Court? Is this being kicked down to lower courts? What's going on here?
It's being kicked down to the lower courts. Essentially, what we had here was a request for a preliminary injunction. In other words, the lower court, the district court, basically said, okay, take the drug off the market in the preliminary injunction. And so then it got appealed to the Fifth Circuit, and the entire Fifth Circuit didn't hear it, but a Fifth Circuit panel heard it. And as you know, and as you stated, the Fifth Circuit basically allowed the drug to remain on the market, but enforced the other restrictions, which was to not allow it to be, you know, distributed through the mail, as well as required additional doctor's visits. And it also forced the pill to be taken in a shorter period of time. Those things are detrimental for access to abortion. It then got appealed to the Supreme Court. Again, that Fifth Circuit panel decision. And what the Supreme Court said today was, okay, we're going to grant the extension of relief for the FDA. That means that the FDA and the Biden administration have some breathing room. In other words, the drug will remain on the markets without any restrictions, allowing it to be mailed, allowing for it to be purchased through the mail and distributed through the mail. And so it really assisted with keeping that drug on the market, but it didn't allow it forever. Essentially, what's happening now is it's going back to the Fifth Circuit for the entire Fifth Circuit justices to actually hear the merits of the preliminary injunction to make substantive determinations, or at least to make some type of determination as to whether or not those the FDA approval from 2000, as well as the 2019 approval, as well as the other restrictions, should remain in place or should not remain in place. And then what's going to happen is, based on the Supreme Court's ruling today, the stay will remain after the Fifth Circuit makes this opinion, so long as there is a writ for cert. In other words, so long as whoever appeals asks the Supreme Court to hear the merits again. And this would allow the Supreme Court to actually not only address the stay, but actually the merits underlying the preliminary injunction. And if the Supreme Court says, hey, we're not going to hear it, then the Fifth Circuit's full opinion will remain in place. If the Supreme Court does take it up and actually hear it on its merit, where there's oral argument and there's briefing, then that stay will remain until the Supreme Court makes a decision.
So many possible directions for this to go. Kristen, thanks so much for joining us. It has been another busy week of severe weather, and we are keeping an eye on the forecast again heading into the weekend. Bill Kerins is standing by with the storms in parts of Ohio and South Texas. He's watching for the concerns of isolated tornadoes, but we're going to start tonight in Oklahoma. The sheriff in McLean County says everyone has been accounted for in that small town of Cole. An EF3 tornado was on the ground for 11 miles Wednesday night, destroying a lot of the community of just 600 people. And across the state, three people were killed. NBC's Priscilla Thompson is in Cole. Priscilla, I know you spoke with one woman who survived the tornado. You've been talking a little bit about how they survived. It looks like you're down in a tornado shelter. Tell us what happened.
Exactly, Gadi. She heard the sirens going off and she ran out of her house, her and her fiance, and came down here into this storm shelter where they sheltered. And when she came out, this is what she saw. Her entire home had been destroyed. And she talked to me about thinking about what might have happened if they have stayed in that house. This was an EF3 tornado. We're talking about more than 150 mile per hour winds. And I want to show you some of the strength of that outside of the devastation that you see here, but the hinges of this storm shelter, this metal door that she told me weighs around 50 to 60 pounds coming off of the hinges. They were not even able to close it. They literally got down there just in time to save their lives. And these are some of the stories that we're hearing from people throughout this community. But I want to play a little bit of what she shared as she showed me around the property. Take a listen.
This dirt, long dirt, was where our house was.
This was the house?
Yes, yes, ma'am. This this end was my bedroom. see this hole right here? There's a huge rock over there that it moved.
Wow. And so what, that was your back
that
porch?
That was my back porch. And I have the best built deck in the world.
And there were others who were able to shelter in their homes. One woman described hiding under her bar counter, holding the hand of her husband as they watched their walls fall around them, the roof be pulled off of their home. And so those are some of the survival stories that we're hearing. But of course, we also know that there were three people in several different counties that did not survive this devastating tornado. Gadi?
I can't imagine what would have happened if she was outside. Sorry, but just the concrete that you showed, was it concrete and then metal? And then from what we saw, that concrete and metal started ripping up from the door when the tornado was pulling at it?
Yeah, so you've got concrete all down here inside the bunker, and then this is actually metal. So there's a concrete platform, but all of this is metal. And yeah, the hinge is literally coming off. They weren't even able to shut the door because of the force of the winds as they were here.
How many people were down there?
There were two people down there. It was a woman and her fiance, and then she also was able to bring two of her dogs down here. And one of her dogs, she actually had to leave up here, and thankfully they were able to find that dog and she survived. But she and her fiance, along with their two dogs, down here, it's very empty and bare down here, and they tell me there were shingles coming off the roof, and they could just feel the shingles falling inside of there. But thankfully, they survived.
Yeah, thank God for that storm shelter. Priscilla Thompson, thanks so much. Yeah. And turning now to NBC's Bill Kerins, who's watching storm threats tonight and into the weekend. Hey, Bill, what can you tell us?
Well, good evening to you, Gadi. And yeah, we're once again tracking severe storms. Not a surprise. This is the peak of our severe season. We're hoping not to have a repeat of what happened with those tornadoes in Oklahoma and also through Kansas and Iowa. But we will see isolated strong storms. We've already had a bunch of them in southern portions of Texas, very large hail-producing storms. And that's kind of the threat that we're going to be watching, isolated severe storms. And that includes areas from Ohio up into areas of western New York, a little sliver here of Pennsylvania, Mississippi. We're going to watch storms rolling through till about probably midnight or so, and then they'll begin to weaken. Now, we've had some big hail-producing storms around McAllen and also heading towards Brownsville, and that'll continue, and then they'll die off about after midnight. Tomorrow's threat, a little more widespread, affecting a larger population center, especially in the mid-Atlantic, from D.C., a good chunk from Virginia, from Richmond, heading all the way down to Williamsburg, and then Norfolk, Virginia Beach, the Raleigh area, to Cape Hatteras, the New Bern, the Havelock, Wilmington, Myrtle Beach, to Charleston. This area, it's going to be about a 2 to 3 hour period of storms. It looks to be late afternoon and then ending as we head into the evening. The isolated tornadoes, but it looks like wind damage and hail will be the biggest threats as we go throughout your Saturday. So keep that in mind, because of course this is the outdoor season, people doing their yard work, you got a lot of sporting events outside. So here's the timing of it through the overnight, kind of everything kind of weakens, then it flares back up tomorrow afternoon. I pause this at 7 p.m. That looks like when it's right over the top of Washington, D.C., all the way back down through Fredericksburg. Richmond, it looks like between 5 to 7 is the worst for you. The Norfolk area, storm should be arriving between 7 to 9 p.m., and then this line will be exiting Raleigh by about the dinner hour, heading towards the Outer Banks as we head towards the evening. And then, unfortunately, this system is going to kind of linger a little bit. It's going to be an ugly Sunday from Boston to Portsmouth to Portland, Maine, and much of New Hampshire, too, is going to be kind of rainy and cool and windy. So not a great Saturday's your day in New England. Saturday's the day to get out there, do whatever you have to do, because it's not going to be so nice on your Sunday. In New York City, by the way, Saturday's fine. It looks like about 9 p.m. is when the rain will move in. In New York City and Philly, you kind of get lucky because most of the rain is going to be during the overnight period. And then on Sunday, we're also going to get soaked there in areas of South Texas. And as far as the rainfall goes, what we really need is that rainfall in the mid-Atlantic region. We will get that from Washington, D.C. to New York, especially in southern New England. Gadi, we could be talking about 1 to 2 inches. This isn't like an epic drought or anything, but you know, we've only seen about 50% of the normal rainfall in this area, and we'll get at least 1 to 2 inches as we go throughout Saturday night into Sunday. So good, some good. My lawn needs it. Right now, it's not looking great.
Bill, thank you. Right now in Idaho, there is this insane murder trial happening that we need to get you caught up on. It's the so-called doomsday mom, Lori Vallow. She's accused of killing her two children, JJ and Tylee. And if those names sound familiar, it might be because there's this whole Netflix docuseries on this called The Sins of Our Mother. Now, this case first started grabbing headlines back in 2019 when Vallow ran off to Hawaii while her kids were still missing. It took police 7 months to find them. And when they did, the kids were buried in the backyard of her husband, who also is facing murder charges. And on top of all of that, the two of them were allegedly members of a cult-like doomsday group and thought JJ and Tylee, among others, were possessed by zombies. Now, both Vallow and her husband have pleaded not guilty. And that brings us to where we are today, 3 weeks into Lori Vallow's murder trial. And joining us now is Alexandra Duggan from our local station in Boise. Alexandra, you've been in the courtroom following this case so closely. We've been following your coverage of this. So can you bring us up to speed here? Who did we hear from this week, and what are the key moments that really stood out to you?
Right. Well, we heard like a lot from family in the first week, kind of setting the scene for what happened to Tylee and JJ. But this week we've been hearing a lot from experts and law enforcement and people to kind of solidify that timeline of what happened before and after the children went missing, and kind of how the religion aspect played a lot into Chad and Lori's life and how they, you know, treated the people around them and kind of what they were doing right before the children went missing.
And with a case like this, this has a whole Netflix documentary about it. I'm sure you've watched all of that. So many people following along have seen it. There's a lot of information already out there. Are there a lot of new details coming out that we just didn't know before?
I would mostly say the evidence that we are seeing physically in the courtroom is a really big deal. The autopsy photos of the children were shown to the jury, and I can tell you that a lot of those jurors were completely shocked, and it was honestly very, very hard to see. We saw how JJ was found. We saw him lying on the autopsy table, and we saw what was left of Tylee. And I think that, you know, a lot of people had a hard time in the courtroom seeing those things. And also we know that Tammy Daybell was asphyxiated, and that was kind of, you know, mentioned by her family, but we've never actually had it confirmed. And we had it confirmed by prosecutors in the courtroom.
Yeah, it's so odd when something that people watch almost for entertainment comes to life in a courtroom, and then people realize, wow, these are people's lives that we're talking about. On Monday, the jury will come back to court. What do you think we're going to start seeing next week?
Because of the witness list is sealed, we don't actually know who will be testifying. But they've gone through a lot of testimony already, and I think that we are going to just start seeing them really weave that timeline together and solidify more about Lori and her life, and kind of the experts that are coming in are going to at least be able to try and prove that Lori was involved in this somehow in some way. And I think that the prosecution is kind of going back and forth from, you know, Charles Vallow back to the children. And I think that's going to start coming together slowly so we can see a perfect picture.
Alexandra, thanks so much. We're looking forward to more of your reporting. And still ahead this hour, hundreds are dead after the seventh day of fighting in Sudan. Now, the U.S. is preparing evacuation plans for some Americans there. Then we're going to take you to one zoo's baby boom to help save an endangered species. And later, would you eat meat grown in a laboratory? There are some companies raising the stakes in the race for lab-grown food. So stay tuned. Welcome back. There is a lot happening around the world right now, so let's bring you the biggest headlines in just 80 seconds. At least 10 people are dead in South Africa after gunmen opened fire in the city of Pietermaritzburg. Police say at least four gunmen ambushed a family there. Two suspects are now in custody. A third was shot and killed, and the fourth got away. All the victims were members of the same family, with the youngest being a 13-year-old boy. And Russia bombs one of its own cities. The country's defense minister says that a Russian missile meant for Ukraine was dropped on the Russian city of Belgorod last night, and that explosion left a massive crater, damaged several apartment buildings, and hurt three people. Apparently, the blast was so strong that it flipped a parked car into the air, and then it landed on a roof of a nearby store. And a lot of people are trying to nab a ticket for the Paris Olympics next summer. Around 4 million applicants have been submitted for the lottery so far. And by the way, that lottery is just for a chance to buy a ticket. That doesn't mean that you're guaranteed to get one, but if you are one of the lucky 4 million applicants, you'll know next month if you've been chosen. By the way, the games will take place next summer from July 26th to August 11th. In Sudan, where the country seems to be on the brink of an all-out civil war, there's supposed to be a temporary ceasefire in place right now, but it doesn't look like it's holding up. That ceasefire was supposed to be the last 3 days for the celebration of Eid. It's a holiday that marks the end of Ramadan, but the State Department says they are getting reports that the fighting is still going on. Sudan's army and its paramilitary force have been fighting for control of that country for a week now. Over 600 people have been killed so far, including at least one American. Roughly 16,000 Americans are on the ground in Sudan right now, sheltering in place. The U.S. is asking that they coordinate their own safety arrangements amid all that chaos.
Americans should have no expectation of a U.S. government-coordinated evacuation at this time. It is imperative that U.S. citizens in Sudan make their own arrangements to stay safe in these difficult circumstances.
Courtney Hubie covers national security in the Pentagon for us. Courtney joins us now. Courtney, we heard the State Department say, they pretty much said that they're not going to be able to help private U.S. citizens in Sudan right now. That paints a very dire picture. What are Americans there that are supposed to do? I mean, we just heard 16,000 Americans in Sudan. The borders are closed. The airport's closed. What now?
Yeah, that's right. And we heard the same thing out of the State Department or out of the White House yesterday from John Kirby, saying that Americans need to continue to shelter in place and keep themselves safe. But at this point, it's just simply too dangerous for a large-scale evacuation of those 16,000 Americans. I actually spoke with an American who's there in Khartoum who said that of the 72-hour ceasefire that both sides agreed to for the Eid holiday, she said, you know, it was a 72-hour ceasefire that lasted about 72 minutes, citing the fact that she's hearing gunfire, artillery, and even airstrikes since it was the so-called ceasefire was agreed to only hours ago. So, and I should point out, it's not the first ceasefire that the both sides have agreed to that has not held in the seven-day-long conflict. So Americans there are being urged to continue to shelter in place, but the concern is that in many cases they don't have running water, there's problems with electricity, and some seem to be running out of food. The situation is becoming increasingly concerning to U.S. officials back here in the States, leading the U.S. military, the Pentagon, to deploy forward, to pre-position some military forces in nearby Djibouti in case there is a need for an evacuation in the coming days, Gadi.
such a terrifying time for everybody in that country. So if the United States repositions those troops in nearby Djibouti, what are the hopes of evacuating the U.S. embassy staff during a potential ceasefire down the road?
So the U.S. military is trained for this very occasion. We've seen it occur, frankly. You know, there was massive fighting in Libya in 2014. The military went in and they actually drove out about 150 Americans, including a large contingent of U.S. Marines who were guarding the embassy there. So they can go into a contested environment and bring people out. But it's extremely difficult. It's extremely dangerous. It's a large logistical undertaking. One of the biggest concerns here is the airports are shut down. Now, we just got late word tonight that one of the sides that's fighting is open to reopening one of the airports, the one specifically in Khartoum. But the problem is right now, it's not really clear who controls that airport and whether that would actually stick. That would be a big step forward. The other problem is if these ceasefires continue to break and there is no truce, U.S. troops could come under fire. So what it would take is highly trained U.S. military and a larger footprint to come in. All those Americans would have to get to one central place, and it would have to be a coordinated and very quick effort to get them out safely. At this point, the U.S. has not ordered or asked the military to do that, but according to two officials who've been briefed with this on the planning for this, the Biden administration is leaning towards an evacuation of those several dozen U.S. government officials who are assigned to the embassy there in Khartoum, Gadi.
Terrifying situation that just seems to get worse. Courtney, thank you. Now, Earth Day is tomorrow, but not just for us humans. Technically, it is Earth Day for all of us who share this planet every day, which takes us to a zoo in England. And it's making huge strides in protecting endangered species by helping make more babies. So get ready for a cuteness overload, because NBC's Kelly Cobier is about to give us an inside look at the baby boom going on at the Chester Zoo.
Playtime for two of the world's rarest big cats. They're Sumatran tiger cubs, critically endangered, with only 350 in the wild. Alif and Raya were born in January, both healthy females. The cubs, among 12 endangered species born at Chester Zoo in the past 9 months, including a Malayan tapir, a Western chimpanzee, a greater one-horned rhino, a giant anteater, and this little guy, born last summer and just now showing his face. Tucked inside mom's pouch is a baby Goodfellow's tree kangaroo, a joey.
You can see the joey.
Unlike their much bigger Australian cousins, these animals spend their entire lives in the trees.
They're only found in New Guinea, and numbers have dropped alarmingly in recent years.
The zoo didn't know Katawa had given birth until her pouch moved.
When it's born, yeah, it's the size of a jelly
bean.
It's
tiny, yeah, jelly bean, that's right, yeah. Mum will lick a path up for it to climb up to the pouch, and it'll latch onto a teat and slowly grow. We've managed to get a boroscope in and actually film it in the early days in the pouch. And they're sort of rather grotesque-looking little pink things with claws.
Matching animals, like the endangered Komodo dragon, the world's largest venomous lizard, with new mates can be dangerous.
When dragons come together, you don't quite know how it's going to go. If they're not compatible, certainly with a size difference between this huge lizard that's having a bath now, his size difference was of some concern.
But just 2 weeks ago, baby Komodo dragons came out of their shells. A little over 12 inches long, they'll reach adulthood in 8 or 9 years.
On that special day, one pipped, I could see the scales of a dragon. A highlight of my career, so special.
You knew that you had...
You knew
you had healthy babies.
Yeah.
In the lab, the zoo regularly checks animal hormone levels for signs they're healthy and ready to breed, working to breed and protect creatures big and small. The nonprofit zoo works with more than 20 countries around the globe, collaborating with local communities to find the best ways to monitor species and protect their environments. And these recent arrivals are snails from Madeira off the coast of Africa, long thought to be extinct. But a few were discovered and delivered to the care of Chester Zoo just last week.
We got a call and said, yeah, we found 20. So 20 snails, and they just say, right, we're sending it to you. Try to do the best that you can, because that's the last hope that we have it until the habitat is restored and is in good conditions.
Hoping top scientists can add to the zoo's baby boom, giving some of the most threatened animals in the world a better chance to survive in the wild.
Oh, thanks, Kelly. And if you can't get enough of that, be sure to watch our special called Climate Change and Super Solutions, streaming tonight at 10:30 Eastern on NBC News Now. NBC's Al Roker shows us a bunch of ways people are working together to slow down climate change and the massive ways life is changing in the face of our climate crisis. And coming up, a wall built in Baltimore that many consider racist has come down. We're going to tell you why it was there in the first place. But first, you got to see this. 24/7 security on Hawaii's Kaimana Beach for a VIP. That is a very important pup. This monk seal pup and its mom will make the shore their home for about a month and a half during their nursing period. And conservation officials have fenced off that beach. Plus, officers on jet skis are going to guard that mom and the baby when they are in the water. They have their very own seal team. We'll be right back. Thanks for joining us. Let's get you caught up in 30 seconds. The Supreme Court extends the stay on the abortion pill Mifepristone, allowing the medication to remain on the market while the justices take on the case. And sources tell NBC News the Biden administration is leaning toward evacuating U.S. personnel from Sudan. This after the State Department has confirmed one American has been killed. And we are keeping an eye on threats of isolated tornadoes as storms hit parts of South Texas and Ohio tonight. Now turning to Morgan State University in Baltimore, one of the oldest historically black universities in the country. Now, years ago, a brick wall was built to separate Morgan and its predominantly black students from nearby white communities, and it came to be known as the so-called spite wall, a relic of the racism rampant in the surrounding community more than 80 years ago. But today, it is being torn down. NBC's Aaron Gilchrist has the story.
Hey there, that's right. And this
construction crews hard at work rebuilding after tearing down a painful piece of history at Morgan State University.
When Morgan moved here in 1917, this entire community, it was all white, and they did not want a quote-unquote Negro college in their neighborhood.
University President David Wilson described years of protests and efforts to keep Morgan State out of this neighborhood. Ultimately, when the school installed its first black president in 1939, a wall went up.
This wall was to send a signal that the community was not in support of what they called a Negro invasion. They were concerned about their property values. There were even comments that the Negroes would taint the very air that we breathe. There were comments that we'd rather be neighbors to ignorant blacks than educated blacks.
Green says segregation or spite walls were not uncommon across the post-Civil War U.S. In the end, the spite aimed at Morgan State stood more than 1,200 feet long and more than 7 feet high. But last week, the wall came down. This day coming years after the university bought part of the old shopping center where most of the barrier once stood and raised new education buildings around it. Buildings on the same site where in the 1950s Morgan State students once demonstrated to integrate the movie theater and other businesses that predominantly served the residents on the other side of that wall. Tearing it down starts the last phase of hundreds of millions of dollars in development, a symbolic opening of a path to the future that brought tears to President Wilson's eyes.
I realized at that moment the amount of hate that actually went into building a physical barrier to prevent people like me from simply walking across the street. It's finally time for hope to rise.
Wilson says that progress happening with input from both the city of Baltimore and the surrounding communities. Today, the historically black university is thriving with an expanding footprint and more than 9,000 students.
Yeah, I'm definitely glad it's gone. Definitely glad it's gone. Shouldn't have been up in the first place.
I am actually glad that our university is knocking it down and we're able to move forward and progress as a university, and like students don't just have to be reminded of this thing.
A portion of this wall is still standing and it will stay up. The purpose changes though. It now becomes a tool for teaching. Architecture professor Dale Green leading the effort to create a historical marker here with signage and photos, an effort to tell a more complete story.
It's often said that there's the history that made America, and then there's the history that America made up. And so we're still trying to right that ship.
Aaron Gilchrist, NBC News, Baltimore.
Aaron, thanks so much for that report. Now to an issue impacting communities nationwide, potholes. You hate to see them. You hate even more to feel them, you know? They seem to be popping up everywhere these days. And when you're wondering why that is, there's an answer. It's extreme weather. It's part of it. And here in Los Angeles, we've been seeing all kinds of rain lately, and that's left a really big dent in our roads. NBC's Kaylee Hartung took to the streets to scope out the problem for us. Hey there, Kaylee.
Hey there, that's right. And this is not just an LA problem. One recent report found that 40% of US roadways are in poor or mediocre condition. So what's causing the big sink? Well, wetter winters and more traffic mean more potholes, and local crews are struggling to keep up with the demand to fill them.
If you're hitting the road this weekend, buckle up. It might be a bumpy ride. Across the country, potholes seem to be popping up faster than crews can fill them.
Because of all of the rain that so many parts of the country experienced, the potholes have just proliferated in many parts of the country.
Former California governor and actor Arnold Schwarzenegger recently took matters into his own hands, terminating what he called a giant pothole in his Los Angeles neighborhood.
For 3 weeks I've been waiting for this hole to be closed.
The video going viral, but the city claiming it was actually a trench for utility work.
Thank you.
The potholes and rough roads in LA are just one example of a bigger problem across the country. Last year, about 44 million drivers, they had to pay for repairs on their cars because of pothole damage.
And it can take a big chunk out of drivers' pockets. The average cost of repairs, over $400, according to AAA.
It could cost much more depending on the type of damage that was done and the type of vehicle that was damaged.
Potholes are caused when water seeps into cracks in asphalt. As cars drive over the weakened surface, it eventually caves under pressure.
Water is the kryptonite of asphalt. And so obviously with a series of rain events, this has just become a really bad situation for our roadways.
Torrential rain and heavy snow across the country this winter, plus overcrowded roads, causing pothole reports to soar and putting a major strain on city and state resources as crews race to patch the problems. After a brutal winter, Salt Lake City held its first ever pothole palooza last week, filling more than 6,000 holes. In Chicago, the Department of Transportation says they're working every day, including weekends in winter and spring, which they've dubbed pothole season, to fix damaged roads. Some local governments are now looking for more funding to keep up with maintenance. The mayor of St. Paul, Minnesota, pushing for a 1% hike to the local sales tax, aiming to raise $1 billion to pay for transportation fixes, including pothole-ridden road repairs, as drivers hope for smoother journeys ahead.
So what can we do to protect our cars from damage? Well, first, take precautions. Make sure your tires are properly inflated. And while driving, keep your eyes on the road and scan for potholes. If you see one, make sure you don't swerve dangerously into another car to avoid them. Sometimes the safest thing to do is slow down while rolling over them. And a lot of cities, like Los Angeles and Chicago, are asking us to act when you see a pothole. Not by filling it yourself, like we saw Arnold Schwarzenegger do, but by calling 311 and reporting the pothole so the city can come and fix it. Back to you.
Pothole Palooza. Kaylee, thanks so much. And coming up on the future of everything, call it AI a la mode. Artificial intelligence isn't just designing clothes, it's creating whole runway shows that could be the next trend for fashion. We're going to show you just how far this can go. And here's some of the other headlines we're watching tonight. The man who police say shot several people in North Carolina, including a six-year-old, was arrested in Florida today. He's been on the run since Tuesday. Now, neighbors say Robert Lewis Singletary started shooting people after a basketball rolled into his yard earlier this week. And Singletary is charged with attempted first-degree murder and assault. And it turns out he was out on bond in a separate case involving him allegedly attacking a woman with a mini sledgehammer. Three people that were shot are recovering. And a school bus driver in Colorado has been fired for intentionally slamming on the brakes with kids on board, saying he was trying to teach them, quote, a lesson. Now, the video has been released with the school district blurring the kids' faces, but a warning, what you're about to see is pretty disturbing.
You guys need to be in your seats. You guys want to see how dangerous that is?
Did you get that? That's why you need to be in your seat. If you guys can't do that, you will get written up. Did you get that?
A driver now faces 30 counts of child abuse. In Texas, this is incredible video. A train smashed into a pickup truck. That truck had already been in an accident just before that happened, forcing it up on those tracks. Now, fortunately, the person in the truck got out in time and appears to be okay. And President Biden signed an executive order today directing his administration to work towards environmental justice. It'll also require federal agencies to notify communities if toxic substances are released from a federal facility. And for the first time since 2006, California is expected to fill 100% of water requests from cities and farms. That's because of all that rain and snow we got this winter. Now, when you think of the future of fashion, what comes to mind? Well, let's take a look-see, shall we, at what's happening right now on one of fashion's biggest stages. Check out this fashion show in New York City. It's the fashion show that anyone who is anyone is talking about. Colorful, futuristic designs like that one right there. They're being judged by the industry's biggest names. The people in the front row, they look pretty impressed. Wait just a minute. Take a close look here. Anything off? Do these look like real people? No. In fact, nothing you see right now is real. Not the model, not the clothes, not the runway, not even the fashion photographer that has taken this picture. There is no fashion photographer. It is all AI generated. Hundreds of collections were submitted to the first ever AI Fashion Week from designers all around the world. The only rule: everything had to be designed 100% virtually, and it's not just the outfits. Participants were also asked to consider all parts of a fashion show, including front row atmosphere and backstage moments. Look at all those pictures. Pretty wild stuff. Here to discuss is Shanae Bovell. She's a model for brands like DKNY, Ferragamo. She's also the founder of the tech education company Away. First off, an AI Fashion Week. What do you think?
I think I myself am a little bit shocked at the pace that things are moving. But I think on the one hand, it's quite exciting. The purpose of fashion is to really push the frontier of design and creativity forward. And that's exactly what we're seeing when we see design in a computer or these AI-generated imagery. At the same time, it does, of course, raise a lot of questions. What does the future of this industry look like? And for all of the professions that rely on it.
And Shanae, talking about some of these other jobs in the fashion world, possibly at risk of being replaced by AI, I mean, how long is that list?
Right. So, of course, as you saw there, we have fashion models, but then also photographers, designers. It changes who gets to be a designer, production, set, crew. There's an entire ecosystem and supply chain. Ultimately, even actually the making of clothes and the demand for physical clothes could change as a result of this. So there's the first, second and tertiary order impacts of AI in the fashion industry.
And Shanae, do you see like a future where real models are still working with the industry, but also with AI studios?
Right, that's a really great question. I think the jury is still out as to how society will respond to AI-generated fashion models and where we'll continue to derive influence from going forward. Even just 15 years ago, the idea of an influencer wasn't really something that most of us were familiar with. And now here we are. So technology continues to challenge and to change the dynamics, especially when it comes to the arts and fashion. But it will be interesting to see, do AI models start to build their own persona and be something that the society now actually adopts to and gravitates towards, or do we find it a little bit uncanny and we might prefer that human element to it? It is really hard to say at this point in time. And in terms of, you know, the big fashion models, will we see them maybe build a digital twin of themselves so they just have more assets for themselves in the digital world? That is also a possibility. So the jury is still out on which direction this goes and how it's received by society.
Sinead, just talking to you, hearing you talk about uncanny and thinking about the uncanny valley and also seeing the faces pop up right next to you in those boxes. I don't know if you saw, but that uncanny valley, I mean, when it comes to pictures, isn't really at play here. I mean, we've made such leaps and bounds when it comes to how realistic all this looks. I do want to ask you, Levi's caught some backlash a few weeks ago after it was announcing it's going to use AI to generate models of more diverse body types and skin tones. What concerns do you have about companies using this technology and also trying to represent humans, but they're not like using humans at all?
Yes, so this is a concern that I kind of flagged about a year ago, and I call it the diversity illusion, where we can see potentially brands automating identities, but essentially putting diverse bodies into those avatars, into those AI-generated human identities, but the people behind the screen actually coding those AI-generated figures aren't diverse themselves. And this creates this diversity illusion, and I think can be quite problematic going forward. With Levi's, they quickly walked back that statement that it was to enhance diversity. They said that it wouldn't actually lead to any cuts of physical models, of human models. But that's something that we have to be really cognizant of. Who's actually getting automated and whose identity is going to continue to get profited off of?
And Sinead, this is a very weird question because it's not something that you hear in the same sentence, but like fashion, AI regulation, what do you think?
Right. So I think with fashion, what you have maybe also seen over the past couple of weeks are things like an AI-generated Pope Francis in a Balenciaga-inspired jacket. So in the same world and with the same technology, the idea of transparency, of watermarks when we see AI identities or AI-generated humans, that could be a conversation that we want to have. And should we do things like mandate watermarks when people come across AI-generated identities just to prevent any form of manipulation and any form of uncertainty? And I think people might feel a little bit more comfortable if we have some of those guardrails and safety measures in place.
Such a fascinating look ahead. Sinead, thanks so much for being with us.
Thanks for having me.
So we've talked the future of fashion, but what about the future of food? Right now, more than 150 companies are working to make lab-grown meat and seafood a reality, and they think they're closer than ever to getting that lab meat into restaurants and onto store shelves near you. And NBC's Maya Eaglin has that story.
It's Big Tech's newest take on Big Ag. No farmland, no coops. But these labs in Silicon Valley could be the future of meat.
There are a lot of benefits of making meat in this way, from 70% less emissions, 70% less water and land. But one of the biggest is you don't need to harm an animal.
Josh Tetrick is the CEO of Eat Just. It's one of only two companies in the U.S. that's received clearance from the FDA for human consumption of lab-grown meat. The USDA still needs to approve it for sale.
This is not vegan or vegetarian.
The other company is Upside Foods, headed by cardiologist Uma Valetti.
Talk to me about the science here. How does it work?
The science is fascinating, but it's fairly simple. We take cells from eggs or young animals or mature animals, and we identify the cells that are capable of going into fats, proteins, connective tissue.
Those cells are then prepped in a lab and pumped into stainless steel vessels.
Inside this bioreactor tank, there are billions of chicken cells growing. It'll take about a month before they're ready to eat.
Right now in the U.S., you can only eat cultivated chicken on company premises.
Definitely has the chew factor
yeah.
of chicken. Shreds like chicken, too.
Yeah.
It's soft in texture. I have to say, it very, 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 very close.
On average, Americans eat 100 pounds of chicken a year. But raising livestock comes at a cost, contributing 14.5% of all human-caused greenhouse gas emissions, according to the U.N. The companies making lab-cultivated meat say they can fix that, if they can bring down their costs. Currently, the only place in the world you can buy cultivated meat is in Singapore, where Eat Just sells its chicken at a financial loss.
So if the motivation isn't profit here, why sell in Singapore?
Selling in Singapore is a way of demonstrating that this new approach to making meat is not science fiction, but it's here, it's reality.
Experts say lab-grown chicken showing up on store shelves in the U.S. is likely still years away.
There's a ton of risk in doing this. There's a lot of uncertainty. But the other option is not to do anything. and that seems worse.
Pushing for change, one bite at a time.
NBC's Maya Eaglin joins me now. So Maya, between us friends,
yes.
How did it really taste?
Gadi, it tasted good. It tasted like chicken because it is chicken. So I tried a dumpling, I tried two fillets, and I tried chicken salad, and the flavor was there. You get the umami, you get the texture. I will say there is something different about it, but the chefs both told me that, you know, they're evolving this recipe and the next version is already in the works. Gadi.
How much sauce did you actually put on there? Because, I mean, you've got a chef involved. Anytime you go to these taste tests, I'm always like, can I just have just the meat?
Yes.
And they're like, well, hold on, but let me put some salt on it. I mean, do you think that a lot of it was because it was dressed up?
They definitely rolled out the red carpet. You're not wrong about that. But I could not tell the difference, especially with the ground dumpling. It really just tasted like a chicken dumpling. But I will say there is something in my mind where I'm not sure if I was looking for the differences or I could really tell, like, this one is a little too soft, this one's a little too chewy. I am optimistic, though. I think as they continue to develop it, you won't be able to tell the difference in a few years.
And when we're talking about lab-grown meat, what we're talking about is basically taking a cell from a living thing and then growing it in a petri dish. And hypothetically, that living thing could still be alive by the time you're eating the meat, right?
Yeah,
absolutely. Is that just wild?
That is wild, and it's a more ethical way of consuming meat. That's one of the claims of this company. You can also take it from an egg. You can also take it from just a chicken fillet. So this is not something for vegans or vegetarians. You know, this is kind of an alternative way to consume meat where you don't have to feel bad about the environmental impact or the resources or animals being killed to do it.
I just think about, like, a little chicken running across the street there and being like, you're delicious while I'm eating it. Last question, real fast. Realistically, how long do you think it'll be before we see these on grocery store shelves?
$1 million question. I think the companies would say 5 to 10 years. The critics could say decades or possibly never. There is a lot that still needs to be developed and invested in here, so we really won't know, but I can guarantee you not this year. Gadi.
All right. Maya Eaglin, thanks so much. That does it for us this week. I'm Gadi Schwartz. We'll see you next week, but until then, stay tuned now.
Thanks for watching our YouTube channel. Follow today's top stories and breaking news by downloading the NBC News app.